The Lancashire Witches 1612-2012 by Robert Poole. Not long after 10 Lancashire residents were found guilty of witchcraft and hanged in August 1612, the official proceedings of the trial were published by the clerk of the court Thomas Potts in his The Wonderful Discovery of Witches in the County of Lancaster. 400 years on, Robert Poole reflects on England's biggest witch trial and how it still has relevance today. Woodcut of Witches Flying, from Mather's Wonders of the Invisible World, 1689, and used in an 18th-century pamphlet about the Lancashire witches. 400 years ago, in 1612, the northwest of England was the scene of England's biggest peacetime witch trial, the Trial of the Lancashire Witches. 20 people, mostly from the Pendle area of Lancashire, were imprisoned in the castle as witches. 10 were hanged, 1 died in jail, 1 was sentenced to stand in the pillory, and 8 were acquitted. The 2012 anniversary sees a small flood of commemorative events, including works of fiction by Blake Morrison, Carol Ann Duffy and Jeanette Winterson. How did this witch trial come about, and what accounts for its enduring fame? We know so much about the Lancashire witches because the trial was recorded in unique detail by the clerk of the court, Thomas Potts, who published his account soon afterwards as The Wonderful Discovery of Witches in the County of Lancaster. I have recently published a modern English edition of this book, together with an essay piecing together what we know of the events of 1612. It has been a fascinating exercise, revealing how Potts carefully edited the evidence, and also how the case against the witches was constructed and manipulated to bring about a spectacular show trial. It all began in mid-March when a peddler from Halifax named John Law had a frightening encounter with a poor young woman, a Litson device, in a field near Caen. He refused her request for pins and there was a brief argument during which he was seized by a fit that left him with his head drawn awry, his eyes and face deformed, his speech not well to be understood, his thighs and legs stark lame. We can now recognize this as a stroke, perhaps triggered by the stressful encounter. A Litson device was sent for and surprised all by confessing to the bewitching of John Law and then begged for forgiveness. When a Litson device was unable to cure the peddler, the local magistrate, Roger Noel, was called in. Characterized by Thomas Potts as God's justice, he was alert to instances of witchcraft, which were regarded by the Lancashire's Puritan-inclined authorities as part of the cultural rubble of popery, Roman Catholicism, long overdue to be swept away at the end of the county's very slow Protestant Reformation. With weeping tears, Alitson explained that she had been led astray by her grandmother, Old Demdike, well known in the district for her knowledge of old Catholic prayers, charms, cures, magic, and curses. Noel quickly interviewed Alitson's grandmother and mother, as well as Demdike's supposed rival, Old Chotix, and her daughter Anne. Their panicky attempts to explain themselves and shift the blame to others eventually only ended up incriminating them, and the four were sent to Lancaster Jail in early April to await trial at the Summer Assizes. The initial picture revealed was of a couple of poor, marginal local families in the Forest of Pendle with a long-standing reputation for magical powers, which they had occasionally used at the request of their wealthier neighbors. There had been disputes, but none of these were part of ordinary village life. Not until 1612 did any of this come to the attention of the authorities. Illustration from James Crossley's Introduction to Potts' Discovery of Witches in the County of Lancaster, 1845, reprinted from the original edition of 1613. The net was widened still further at the end of April when Alitson's younger brother James and younger sister Janet, only 9 years old, came up between them with a story about a great meeting of witches at their grandmother's house, known as Malkin Tower. This meeting was presumably to discuss the plight of those arrested and the threat of further arrests, but according to the evidence extracted from the children by the magistrates, a plot was hatched to blow up Lancaster Castle with gunpowder, kill the jailer and rescue the imprisoned witches. It was, in short, a conspiracy against royal authority to rival the gunpowder plot of 1605, something to be expected in a county known for its particularly strong underground Roman Catholic presence. Those present at the meeting were mostly family members and neighbors, but they also included Alice Nutter, described by Potts as a rich woman who had a great estate, and children of good hope, in the common opinion of the world, of good temper, free from envy or malice. Her part in the affair remains mysterious, but she seems to have had Catholic family connections, and may have been one herself, providing an added motive for her to be prosecuted. She was, along with a number of others named by the children, rounded up, and by the time of the trial in August the Pendle accused had been joined in the dungeons of Lancaster Castle by other alleged witches from elsewhere in the county. All 19 were tried in the space of 2 days, amid dramatic courtroom scenes. 10 of them were hanged the next day on Lancaster Moor, high above the town and overlooking Morecambe Bay. It was probably the first time any of them had seen the sea. Alice Nutter and several other defendants defied convention by refusing to offer any confession on the gallows. To many of those present at the hanging, this would have seemed like proof of innocence, and it may have been such rumblings about the trial that prompted the trial judges to ask the clerk of the court, Thomas Potts, to take the unusual step of publishing an account of it. In truth, Potts had already had a large hand in organizing the trial itself and may well have suggested the publication in the first place. He certainly used it to curry favor with King James I, whose book Demonology he cited several times, proclaiming how the authorities had followed the king's advice on uncovering cases of witchcraft in the Lancashire trial. The Lancashire trial was then cited from the 1620s onwards as the legal precedent for using child and supergrass evidence in witchcraft cases. Indirectly, the trial of the Lancashire witches may have influenced the notorious witch-finder general trials of the 1640s and even the Salem witch trials of the 1690s in New England. Thomas Potts, as he was imagined in Harrison Ainsworth's The Lancashire Witches, A Romance of Pendle Forest, 1850, illustrated by Sir John Gilbert. The modern fame of the Lancashire Witches is down to the publication in 1849 of an imaginative novel by Harrison Ainsworth, a friend of Charles Dickens with local connections and one of the best-selling Victorian novelists. His novel The Lancashire Witches has never been out of print, and it was successful in part because it drew on an edition of Potts' original book published in 1848 by Ainsworth's friend James Crossley, the Manchester antiquarian. Ainsworth has in turn inspired many other publications and theories. The trial began to receive serious academic attention in the 1990s, pulled together in a book of essays which I edited for Manchester University Press, The Lancashire Witches, Histories and Stories. In 2012, an international conference at Lancaster University, Capturing Witches, will bring together the latest work, both factual and fictional. No fewer than 5 new novels have appeared, most notably Jeanette Winterson's At Daylight Gate, as well as a book of verses by Blake Morrison, A Discovery of Witches, and a BBC documentary, The Pendle Witch Child. The remarkable range of new work testifies to the richness of historical themes thrown up by the trial, but I would like to single out one in particular, children and witchcraft. Much of the key evidence in the trial of 1612 was given by 2 children, James and Janet Device, aged about 9 and 12. Caught up in a terrifying web of charges and arrests, they panicked, and their stories, designed to clear themselves, ended up in the deaths of most of their own family members, and indeed of James himself. In some parts of the world, children continue to be accused of witchcraft and to suffer horrific maltreatment as a result. A case of a Nigerian child in London, tortured and murdered by their own family for being a witch, recently hit the national headlines. Lancaster, home of the 1612 trials, is also home of Stepping Stones Nigeria, a campaigning charity dedicated to protecting children from accusations of witchcraft and other abuse. It has been adopted as the charity of the Lancashire Witches 400 program. There could be no better way of marking the anniversary of the Lancashire Witches trials than to visit their website and learn more about how witchcraft remains a live issue, 400 years on.